Hi, my name is Louis DeVette. I'm the lead programmer at the Chinese Room. I've been programming for over 21 years before joining the Chinese Room here in Brighton last year. I've worked on 13 other titles on many platforms like PlayStation, Xbox, and mobile. The Chinese Room is based here in Brighton on the south coast of England and is part of the Happy Sumo Digital family. The Chinese Room has released a few other titles over the years, like Dear Esther and Everybody's Gone to Rapture, but Little Orpheus is our first arcade title and was released on the 12th of June 2020. Little Orpheus is a gorgeous 2.5D platformer that tells the story of how Ivan Ivanovich went to the center of the Earth and returned some 3 years later. Our game is a very cinematic experience, with lots of dramatic set pieces and hilarious dialogue. This talk, however, is more about the technical aspects of the game and geared towards programmers that use the power of Unity to bring their games to life. So what I really want to talk about is optimization. But before we can do that, we need to talk about target devices, engine choice, and of course, Apple Arcade. Today, I'll try to answer some of these questions. What does it mean to target Arcade as a platform? What was our target devices? How was Little Orpheus made? What engine tools, scene layout, and tech did we use? And then, optimization. How did we manage to get the game to not be too big and run smoothly on 30 frames per second on even the lower end devices? I will try to answer these questions and give you lots of tips on how to achieve this in your games as well. So let's dive in. Arcade requires your game to run on a Mac, iPhone, iPad, and Apple TV. You're required to support all devices that can install iOS 13, tvOS 13, and macOS 10.15 or higher. You'll also have to support MFI controllers, and that includes DualShock, PS4, and Xbox controllers as well. iCloud and Game Center integration is also required. And any third-party plugins that you use will have to also provide source code. So as I said, I wanted to talk about optimization. So some of these requirements might give us an idea of where to start with creating budgets and minimum spec. Because of the minimum OS requirements for Arcade, our lower spec devices were not the same as the normal App Store requirements. Lower spec devices gives us a minimum memory size and an idea of CPU and GPU power. In general, knowing which devices you target also tells us about aspect ratios, supported features, and what our game could possibly be capable of. We used an iPad Mini 4 as the lowest spec device to do profiling on. This device gives us a high ratio between screen resolution and GPU and CPU power. Note that these devices aren't that bad. They are only about 5 or 6 years old in general, but it still proved to us a challenge. Also, only a small proportion of your players will actually be using this device. During development, we used iPhone 8 as our go-to baseline device. We assumed more people will be playing on this device than the lower-end ones. Everything we did had to look good and run really smooth on this device. We planned scaling back on lower-end devices for some features, but only if there were performance bottlenecks. So how did we make Little Orpheus run on all of these devices? Let's start with the engine and tools. We shipped with Unity 2019.3.11 F1 in June 2020. Perforce for source control, TeamCity for continuous integration and automated upload to TestFlight, Visual Studio for coding, and Microsoft Teams and Azure boards for planning and communication. Our game features lots of cinematic sequences and great music. These are some of the great tools we used to make this possible. We used Wyze for all of our audio, and Cinemachine for getting those great camera shots, combined with Timeline to create great looking sequences. This also allowed us to seamlessly move between gameplay and cutscenes. We also used runtime animation rigging to refine Ivan's animations, like using IK to get his feet to follow the floor geometry. We used addressables, but more on that later. Unity's new input system is great. We did have to write some custom input mappings for some of our controllers on the Mac though. We tested with PlayStation 4, DualShock, Xbox and Nimbus Plus controllers, and don't forget Bluetooth keyboards, Magic keyboards and French keyboards. And a quick tip, if you move a package from the library folder where it's cached to the packages folder, you can see it in Visual Studio's project and access the source code in the debugger, which means you can put breakpoints in it. You can also add them to source control and fix bugs if need be. I think I'll quickly show you a bit more about timeline, cinema machine, and runtime animation rigging in Unity. The first example is our title sequence. So the title sequence, we use an orthographic camera and flat shading on 3D models to create the effect inspired by Saul Bass's 50-60s title sequences. The next example is how we use Cinema Machine to move the camera along with Ivan. On the right is the game view and on the left is the scene view, showing the camera tracking Ivan's position. We place the spline in our scene that represented the path that Ivan can take through our level, and confined Ivan to only move forward and backward along that based on user input. Here you can see one of Cinema Machine's great features, Framing Composer. Framing Composer allows you to set a target transform to follow at a specified distance, and it will smoothly move the camera to always have that target inside its view. We created a script that will move this camera follow target slightly in front of Ivan, which in turn will move the camera where we want it to be. You can see that little yellow dot? That's the camera target. Runtime animation rigging allowed us to apply runtime blends to animations, like multi-aim and IK constraints. We used this on Ivan's feet and hands, to name but one application. Here you can see me toggling the weight from 0 to 1 and back again in real time, while the game is running in the editor. Notice Ivan's feet. Here is another example of animation rigging. We made the Menk look at Ivan as he walks past. To find out who the Menk were, you'll have to play the game though. All these little bits of polish makes the game more immersive for the player and is really important in telling the story. Our game released with 8 episodes. These were split into about 5 to 8 blocks per episode. Our game shipped with around 60 to 70 blocks. Each block was a set of scenes, and between blocks, we will have a short loading screen. The main scene is where the game starts and where we kept our UI and other global assets and code. We mark all of our game objects in this scene as don't destroy on load. To make working in teams easier, we split each block into 3 scenes per block: design, art, and code. Each had a scene they can work in. Each block's scenes were loaded additively at the same time. Sometimes we had overlap, and then we will move assets to the code scene where they can reference each other. To deal with the various supported devices, our strategy was to put each device into a quality category of ultra, high, medium, or low. Generally, I would look at their processor to put them in a category, but I also use their specific hardware model or graphics card, make and model as a guide. These do correspond to Unity's quality settings, but it was much more. We used this to disable features, tweak code parameters to reduce CPU load, and so on. For instance, if a device was determined as low quality, we would set the resolution to 720p, set Unity's quality level to low, disable bloom and chromatic aberration post-processing, reduce the number of segments in a rope simulation to 50%, and so on. This quality system drove all of our logic for runtime optimization settings in our game. It was a core part of how we got the game to run on such a wide range of devices. Note that on a Mac, we allow you to actually change this quality setting so that the player has more control. And this brings me to optimization. Why do we need to optimize? And how do we do it? Optimization has many facets. Your game's total size is limited to 4 GB by the App Store. If it's larger than that, it will get rejected by Apple. You can use on-demand resources, but Apple recommends against that as it's not a great player experience to wait a long time before the game can start playing. If your game reaches around 69% of available memory on the device, it will crash. Reducing GPU and CPU workload also reduces the amount of heat that the device generates. If the device heats up too much, thermal throttling will kick in. Apple also requires you to have a consistent frame rate of 30 or 60 frames per second, depending on your game. We found a few things that can help because Apple has a smaller subset of supported devices than the App Store, and we can leverage that to optimize even further. I'll jump straight in and give you a few tips on each of these. Since we only need to support A8 and above processors, we can change all of the textures in the game to use ASDC compression. We can strip out shader level 1 and 2 from our tvOS and iOS builds, and also any unused shader variants. This can be done at build time by looking for specific keywords when a shader gets compiled and removing the variants manually. Unity wrote a really nice blog post about this. Most of the time, voiceover files can be mono, since stereo is not needed. We used lightmap parameters to generate single lightmaps per scene. We also needed to merge all of our design code and art scenes into a single scene to get Unity to generate a single 1 to 2K lightmap per block. Most of the time, a 1K lightmap will be okay, but sometimes we use 2K lightmaps depending on whether the scene's got a lot of detail. Start with smaller size and only increase if the artist's riot. Use animation keyframe reduction in the animation import settings to reduce the size of animations. This saves memory as well. Beware that this could also sometimes not work and cause artifacts in your animation, so definitely test it out vigorously on different devices. We used addressables to create a custom scene graph for each asset bundle so we can track each asset in the game. We can also log size of each of these assets and see what takes up lots of space. This system is also extensible, and we wrote our own tools to create and analyze asset bundles for optimization. For instance, we wrote a tool to log the complete asset graph for each asset bundle in the game on the build machines. This creates a JSON file with the asset graph in that is stored with the build other build artifacts. Very handy if the build size suddenly goes up and you need to find out why. You just search this file and go through and see. We basically save it sorted by asset bundle size, so the biggest asset bundle is always at the top. Use this duplicate assets analysis tool that comes with addressables. It's sort of built in. This will inspect the scene graph and place all duplicate assets in their own asset bundles. When you're loading levels, load empty scene first, then do a resources unload unused assets and a GC collect manually. We found that light probe data can hang around between level lows. This fixed it. Don't guess, always use the profiler to check memory allocations. When you connect Unity's profiler to a device, you can use the memory snapshot tool to see exactly what is taking up memory on the device. Note that doing this in editor will give totally different results. And take snapshots after a longer playtime, particularly after loading and unloading a few levels. And also take a snapshot after the empty scene was loaded. This will clearly show assets that was not unloaded for some reason. You'll definitely spot things that you don't expect to be there. Don't just disable unused objects. Delete from the scene entirely. They can take up space. Use the profiler to find out what allocates memory every frame. Try to reduce these by caching results. Get component was a culprit we found. Don't use it in update or fixed update calls. Rather, call it in the wake or start and cache the result. Use quality settings to reduce texture size across the game. This is great for lower end devices. Again, use the profiler rather than doing guesswork. I usually quickly look in the editor and then load it on a device if it's not obvious. Use layers to limit collisions between objects. See physics under project settings. Culling is done on a CPU, so the less we do, the better. Reduce the size of the bait occlusion culling data by creating an occlusion area to specify where the camera can be. For a 2.5D platformer that we created, that was perfect because we know exactly where the camera is going to be all the time. Incremental garbage collection reduced massive GC spikes. On GUI calls are slow, so remove them. Add your own logging layer so that wraps debug.log calls so that you can remove all of them in a release build. We found that stack tracing for logging in release builds created a massive spike in performance. So definitely watch out for that one. Again, use the profiling tools provided by Unity and Apple to help in debugging frame rate issues. If you're not familiar with them, watch WWDC conference videos from Apple. That is very insightful. A powerful Mac helps to bring down iteration time and is a very valuable tool. Reducing the resolution that the game renders at is a big performance boost. We use 1080p for higher-end devices, iPhone 8 and above, and 720p for lower-end devices. For some Macs with Intel-based onboard graphics cards, we reduced it even to 600. Using native resolution on some devices will kill performance. Some Retina displays have a lot of pixels. Don't use resolution scaling. Instead, set the resolution explicitly. For debug builds, we added a tool on device that will calculate and track some frame rate statistics for us. We tracked minimum frame rate, minimum 15 frame average, average frame rate, and the mode frame rate, most common measurement. We collected these per checkpoint in the game and per block. The minimum 15 frame average is a good to tell you if the frame drops were short or over a long extended period of time. It's really important to know the difference. Disable some features on lower end devices, post-processing effects and particle systems are good candidates. That will definitely get your frame rate a little bit better. Unity uses a on-demand shader compilation. This means Unity compiles a shader only when it's needed the first time a mesh is being rendered. This will also cause regular frame rate drops. Use shader variant collections per scene to get rid of these drops. Also, use these shader variant collections as references in your scene, not in a global collection, as they cannot be unloaded explicitly. We wrote tools that will build a shader variant collection for us from the compiling shader output found in a log file. You can enable this from the graphics settings. We pass the log file and then output the shader variant collection as a result. On Macs, make sure you always use full screen mode, never windowed mode. Windowed mode reduces performance very much, by up to 90% in some of the tests that we did. We found that sometimes if devices has not been restarted for a while, they will have lower frame rate measurements. Restarting fixed that, unless particularly iPads and iPhones. Unity Editor is very extendable and is relatively easy to write tools for and to help you automate tasks and to find issues. Profile regularly, do not wait till the end to start. It takes longer than you expect. For instance, if you have an overdraw issue, you will need R to fix that most likely. This is best detected early on in production. And always profile on device as well. Profiling in the editor can give you false positives and show issues that do not occur on the device. We started with CPU and memory optimization over a year before we shipped. And that brings me to the end. We're always looking for good talent, so please visit our website for a list of open positions. And thank you so much for listening.